Hello everyone, today's topic is about periodontal flap surgery. So let's discuss about some basics of periodontal flaps. Okay, so first we need to understand the definition of periodontal flap. What is a flap? It is a section of the gingiva and or the mucosa which is separated. How are we separating this? We are surgically separating the gingiva or the mucosa. So this is the separated tissue. Okay, so where are we separating it from? We are separating it from the underlying tissue. And why are we separating? In order to provide the visibility and in order to have the access to the bone and root surface. Okay, so this gingiva is like this previously, right? So we are separating this part of the tissue, this part of the gingiva or the mucosa. We are separating it surgically. Okay, so that we'll have the accessibility to the underlying structures. Okay, so now why are we doing this periodontal flap surgery? Okay, in order to have access to the roots and alveolar bone. So first and primary criteria is to have access. In order to view the roots, in order to view the bone morphology, we are doing the periodontal flap surgery. Next is for the modification of osseous defects, like for the purpose of resective osseous surgery or the regenerative osseous surgery. So in order to have a appropriate morphology of the alveolar bone, in order to modify the defects that are present, we are performing the flap surgery. Next is to perform the repair or regeneration of the periodontium. For the purpose of pocket reduction, we are doing the flap, and to provide the acceptable soft tissue contour. So by doing the flap surgery, we are providing a good soft tissue contour so that it will enhance the plaque control and maintenance by the patient, and it will also improve the aesthetics. So these are all the objectives of the flap surgery. Next, when do we do the access flap surgery or flap surgery? Okay, so the indications include, so first one is the access to the root surface and osseous defects, resective surgery, regenerative surgery. For the purpose of pre-prosthetic surgery, that is before prosthesis placement, we do some kind of surgeries. Those are called as pre-prosthetic surgeries. Okay, periodontal plastic surgery like root coverage. Okay, gingival enlargement, gingivectomy performed in case of gingival enlargement, implant surgery, treatment of abscess. So in gingival enlargement, depending upon the condition, we may either do the gingivectomy or we may do the flap surgery. Okay, now next, contraindications. When should we not perform the flap surgery? If the patient is having some uncontrolled medical conditions, then we should not perform the flap surgery. Poor plaque control. So if the patient demonstrates adequate good plaque control, then only we need to proceed with the surgery. Okay, in patients with poor plaque control, we should not perform surgery. Patients with poor plaque control are a contraindication for periodontal surgery. Next is unrealistic patient expectations or desires, you should not perform. In cases of acute infections, in cases of poor prognosis, that means the tooth loss is inevitable. That is, the tooth is in a poor prognosis and it cannot be saved. Okay, in such cases, we should not do the flap surgery. Okay, and where thorough scaling and root planing and home care will control the lesion. So in few patients, the disease is in a minimal stage wherein the home care, adequate home care by the patient or else the scaling and root planing would be sufficient in order to control the lesion rather than going to the surgery. Okay, so now these flaps, periodontal flaps, can be classified mainly based on three important aspects. The first one is based on the bone exposure. So after we are reflecting the flap, okay, if we are exposing the bone, okay, if the bone is exposed, then it is called as full thickness flap. Okay, if the bone is not exposed, okay, then it is called as partial thickness flap. Okay, so if some amount of periosteum is left on the bone, then it is called as partial thickness flap. We'll look into this later again. Next is placement of the flap after surgery. So we are giving incisions, we are reflecting the flap after the surgery, be it resective or regenerative or a combination surgery, we are placing the flap back into position. If we are placing the flap in the same position, okay, then it is called as non-displaced flap. Okay, if we are displacing the flap, that means if we are altering the position of the flap, then it is called as displaced flap. Okay, non-displaced flap, we are placing the flap back into the original position, like how it was before the surgery. Whereas in displaced flap, we are displacing the flap to a different position. So this displaced flap is of three types. Coronally displaced flap, that means we are placing it more coronally. Apically displaced flap, the flap is placed more apically, or else lateral displacement of flap, the flap is displaced towards the sides. So non-displaced and displaced flap, in the displaced flap, we have the three varieties. Next one is papilla management. So how we are managing the papilla? In that we have two, conventional and papilla preservation. So we'll talk about this later. In conventional, I'll just give you a brief idea here. So if this is, so here is a papilla, right? So if we are incising the papilla here beneath the contact point and we are reflecting the buccal flap and the lingual flap, okay, then it is called as conventional management of the papilla. In case of papillary preservation, we will not give incision in this interdental area. We will give it on the palatal aspect, which I'll talk about later. Okay, in conventional, we are elevating the buccal and the lingual flaps. Remember this. Okay, in papilla preservation, we'll talk about it. Next. So what are the steps of periodontal flap? First, we are giving the incision. After incision, what are we doing? We are reflecting the flap. Later, we are performing thorough debridement. So we are removing all the granulation tissue. We are removing the, we're performing the scaling also. Okay, so we are performing the scaling and root planing. We are removing the calculus deposits. Next, we are placing the flap back in position and suturing. Okay, so after this debridement, we are able to view the bone right now. So we can perform the resective osseous surgery if needed. So we can do the osteoplasty or the osteectomy. Later also we can give the bone graft. Regenerative surgery can also be performed. Okay, so first is the incision. Second is reflection. After that, you'll perform thorough debridement. This is called as open flap debridement. After that, you may perform the resective or regenerative procedures. Then we will do the suturing. Later, we will give the periodontal pack. Okay, periodontal pack or periodontal dressing. Okay, so this is optional. It is not given in all the cases. Some clinicians or some authors prefer placement of periodontal pack, whereas some do not prefer the placement of periodontal pack. Okay, so now incision. So first step is incision. Okay, we are giving incisions. So here it may be horizontal incisions or vertical incisions. Okay, so how are we giving these incisions? With the help of number 15 or number 15 C surgical blade, we are giving the incisions. Now let's see what are these horizontal and vertical incisions. Horizontal, that means these incisions are given in a horizontal, here is these incisions are given in a mesial or distal direction. Whereas vertical incisions means occlusio apical direction. Okay, mesio distal is horizontal incision, occlusio apical is vertical incision. Okay, so horizontal incisions are given in mesial or distal direction, and sometimes what happens is you can reflect the flaps only using the horizontal incisions. That means just by giving horizontal incisions, you can reflect the flap. Okay, how, I mean, if when can we do this? If sufficient access can be obtained. So only if horizontal incisions are given, if sufficient access can be obtained, then we can only proceed with the horizontal incisions. Or if displacement is not anticipated, we are not displacing the flaps apically, laterally, or coronally, then we need not give vertical incisions. Only with horizontal incisions, we can reflect the flap. Okay. So if vertical incisions are not made, then that type of flap is called as envelope flap. Okay. So if only horizontal incisions are given, this is the tooth. Only horizontal incisions are given. Only incisions are given in this direction and flap is elevated. Then this type of flap is called as envelope flap. Okay. Yeah. Next. So in this horizontal incision, it can be scalloped or it can be straight. Okay. So horizontal incision that is following this. So the gingiva is like this, right? Scalloped. Okay, so the horizontal incision that is following the scalloped morphology of the gingiva is called as scalloped incision. Okay, whereas if the incision is following a straight line, it is not following the architecture of the gingiva, then it is called as the straight incision. Okay, so previously what it was done is the straight incision was given and all this part of the gingiva was removed. This is called as interdental denudation procedure. Okay, so this technique was performed previously in order to remove all the inflamed interdental tissue. Now, how does this tissue heal which is removed? This heals by secondary intention. Okay, this heals the secondary intention. But scalloped incision is advantageous because we are preserving the architecture of the interdental structures. Okay, we are preserving the soft tissue that is present over the interdental areas. Okay, whereas in case of straight incision, we are removing all the interdental areas. Okay. So here, in case of straight incision, which is called as here interdental denudation procedure, where we are giving the horizontal incisions, the straight incisions. Okay, in such cases, there will be healing by secondary intention and patient will face a lot of discomfort during the healing because the bone underneath this is exposed, right? So healing will take place, healing will take a longer time. Okay, so there are three basic incisions that are necessary for flap surgery. So these are the internal bevel incision, crevicular incision, and interdental incision. Okay, so we'll talk about this internal bevel, crevicular, and interdental. You need to remember this. Okay, so now let's talk about this bevel and internal bevel incisions. Okay, so the external bevel incision is also called as bevel incision. External bevel incision is also called as bevel incision. Internal bevel incision is also called as reverse bevel incision or inverse bevel incision. Reverse bevel or inverse bevel incision. Okay, so now how are we giving this external bevel incision? It starts at the surface of the gingiva apical to the periodontal pocket. So we will measure the pocket depth beneath the pocket depth. Okay, below the level of the pocket depth, we'll start the incision. And how is this incision proceeding? We are going coronally. Okay, so the incision starts at the gingiva apical to the base of the periodontal pocket. Then coronally, we are moving towards the bottom of the periodontal pocket. Okay, and now the collar is removed, tissue collar is removed. This is called as external bevel incision. Okay, so this external bevel incision is used in gingivectomy. Okay, external bevel incision is used in gingivectomy. Okay, it can be made, this can be made with a scalpel or it can be made with the help of a knife also. We'll talk about gingivectomy also. Okay. So now let's talk about internal bevel incision. Here you can see the clear cut difference. Now, in case of internal bevel incision, this internal bevel incision is starting at the surface of the gingiva and we are directing it apically. In external bevel incision, we have directed the incision coronally, whereas internal bevel, we are directing it apically, okay, to the bone crest. Okay, so it is this incision from which the flap is reflected. So now this inflamed, this pocket wall is removed. Now the flap is reflected. You can see here. Okay, the flap is reflected. So internal bevel incision has three important objectives. Since we are giving incision like this, we are removing this whole pocket lining. So the first one is pocket lining is removed. Okay, whereas second one is this outer surface of the gingiva we are preserving, right? So here only the inflamed pocket wall is removed. All this gingiva we are preserving. Whereas in external bevel, we are removing this whole chunk of gingiva. So here we are preserving the outer surface, uninvolved outer surface of the gingiva. And not only that, it produces a thin flap margin. So since we are eliminating this pocket epithelium, it is producing a thin flap margin so that it will be easily adapted. Okay, so internal bevel incision is the basic incision to the most of periodontal flap procedures. Okay, so we have seen, as we have seen, the first incision is called as internal bevel incision. Second is crevicular and third is interdental incision. Okay, I hope everyone is clear with the external bevel and internal bevel. Okay, next we'll talk about crevicular, crestal, and submarginal incisions. Okay, crevicular, this is the crevis. The sulcus is also called as crevis. Okay, so now crevicular incision is called as intracrevicular incision or intercrevicular incision. Intracrevicular, intercrevicular, all means same. And sulcular incision or intrasulcular incision. So all these incisions are same. The incision is given inside the gingival sulcus. So the incision starts in the gingival crevice and then it is directed apically. Okay, so the incision is starting at the gingival crevice and it is proceeding apically through the junctional epithelium. It is passing the connective tissue attachment. It is touching the bone. This is called as sulcular incision or crevicular incision or the intracrevicular, intercrevicular, intrasulcular or intersulcular incision. Anything is same. So this is the second incision. Okay, first incision is internal bevel. Second incision is crevicular or the sulcular incision. Okay, now next one is, we'll talk about it, is crestal incision. This crestal incision, where is it starting? It is beginning at the marginal gingiva. So it is also called as marginal incision. Okay, so this crestal incision is also called as marginal incision. It is starting at the surface of the gingiva at the gingival margin. Okay, so sulcular incision is starting in the sulcus, whereas crevicular crestal incision is starting at the gingival crest. It is starting at the marginal gingiva and is directed apically. So I hope it's clear. It is now directed apically. It is crossing the epithelium, connective tissue, and touching the bone. Okay, so both sulcular incision and crestal incisions, these are the internal bevel incisions, isn't it? They are directed apically. Okay, so now last one is submarginal incision. Okay, so submarginal incision starts at the surface apical. Okay, it is not starting in the sulcus, it is not starting in the gingival margin, it is starting at a distance from the gingival margin. It starts at the surface apical to the gingival margin, and now it is proceeding and it is touching the bone. Okay, so this is called a submarginal, beneath the level of marginal gingiva. Okay. Yes. So now how to place the submarginal incision? So how much distance? We should understand, right? So marginal incision, we are placing it from the tip of the gingival margin. Crevicular incision, we are placing it in the gingival sulcus. Submarginal means we should know how much distance from the gingival margin the incision should be placed. We should understand, yeah. Right? So as I have already told, that submarginal incision has to be given at a distance from the gingival margin. Right. So what is this distance from the gingival margin? So this distance depends on the transgingival interdental probing depth. Okay. So in the previous classes, I told you about transgingival probing depth. So under anesthesia, you will probe and you will probe till the bone level. Okay. So this is also bone sounding. So this transgingival probing is also called as bone sounding. Okay. So once you measure this transgingival probing depth, 1/2 to 2/3 the transgingival probing depth will be the level at which you will give this submarginal scalloped incision. And where do you take this transgingival probing depth? It will be measured in the interdental areas. So it will be measured at the interdental areas. So if your transgingival interdental probing depth is 6 mm, then your scalloped incision will be placed at 3 mm. Okay, it will be placed 1/2 or 2/3 the transgingival probing depth. Okay, so this submarginal scalloped incision placed will also depend on the keratinized tissue that is present. So here, keratinized tissue means the marginal gingiva plus the attached gingiva. So here, the keratinized tissue is abundant. Okay, so in such cases, your submarginal incision will be placed based on the transgingival probing depth. But in some cases where the keratinized tissue is limited, like in this case, okay, since the keratinized tissue is limited, if you place the submarginal incision based on the transgingival probing depth, then you will eliminate a lot of keratinized tissue, a lot of tissue will be lost. In such cases, the submarginal incision should be placed as close to the gingival margin as possible. Okay, so best is giving a crestal incision. So if you give a crestal incision, it maximizes the retained keratinized tissue. So by giving crestal incision, you will retain a lot of keratinized tissue. So if it is adequate, then we can place a submarginal scalloped incision based on the transgingival probing depth. If it is inadequate, then the incision should be given as close to the gingival margin as possible. In most cases, if crestal incision will minimize the tissue that is lost. Okay. And there is another criteria also, in case of shallow palate, in case of deep palate. Okay, so in case of shallow palate or the narrow palate, what happens if you give the submarginal incision based on transgingival probing depth? What will happen in a shallow palate? The more submarginal an incision, the closer it will be to the midline. So it will be closer to the midline. Okay, whereas in case of high palate, the submarginal incision will remain close to the tooth and it will allow the primary closure of the flap. Okay, so in case of shallow palate, again, if you take the transgingival probing depth and give the submarginal incision, this incision what you give will be far away from the tooth. It will be more closer to the midline. Okay, so in such cases also, you should not give the submarginal incision based on the transgingival probing depth. Okay, whereas in case of high palate, you can give the submarginal incision. Whereas here in case of high palate, since the palate is deep, your submarginal incision will still remain close to the tooth and you can close the flap. The primary closure of the flap is very easy. Okay. So in case of areas where the keratinized tissue is minimal, in case of shallow palate, okay, your submarginal incision should be as close to the gingival margin as possible. Okay. Next. So here we have finished the horizontal incisions. Now we'll talk about vertical incisions. So vertical is clujo-apical directions. So these can be used on one or both the ends of the horizontal incision. So now I have given the horizontal incision. This is the horizontal incision. Like I might give it in the crevice. Okay, I might give the internal bevel incision, whatever. So I have given the horizontal incision. Later, if I am giving the vertical incisions, I can give the vertical incisions on both the sides, or I may give the vertical incisions only on one side. Okay, so if I am giving the vertical incisions on both the sides, then it is called as rectangular flap. If I'm not giving vertical incisions, what is it called? It is called envelope flap, right? So if I'm giving vertical incisions on both the sides, it is called as rectangular flap. If I'm giving vertical incision on only one side, then what is it called? It is called a triangular flap. Okay, so vertical incisions at both the ends are used usually for an apically displaced flap. In order for the flap to displace apically, we need vertical incision. So if you want to displace the flap apically, then we obviously need two vertical incisions. Okay, and these vertical incisions must extend beyond the mucogingival junction to reach the alveolar mucosa. Then only then the flap can be displaced. Okay, yeah. Next is the vertical incision should be avoided in the lingual and the palatal areas. Okay, we should not give vertical incisions on the lingual and palatal areas. Yes, so while giving vertical incisions, we need to avoid some things. Okay, so we should not give vertical incision in the papilla. So this will split the papilla. Never give vertical incisions in the papilla. The vertical incision should be given in order to include the papilla, or else in order to not include the papilla. They should always be given at line angles. Vertical incision should never be given center of the papilla. They should not be given on the radicular surface of the tooth also. Okay. These vertical incisions should be given at the line angles of the tooth. Okay. Next is, you should not give a long, narrow flap. Always the base should be greater than the margin. The base should be wider. Okay, the base should be wider when compared to the margin. Okay, this will provide adequate blood supply. Okay, so flaps with base that is narrower than margin, okay, this will alter the blood supply. This will geopardize the blood supply to the flap. Okay. Yes, and you should never give the long flaps also. Okay, long, narrow flaps should not be given. And flaps with base that is narrow when compared to the margin should not also be given. Okay. Next, so we have given incisions. Now, what is the next step? It is the flap elevation. So we are elevating the flap. So in this, we have two. That is the full thickness and the partial thickness flap. Okay, so in full thickness, what we are doing is, we are reflecting the flap such that the bone is exposed. So here the incision is given. Okay. Later after reflection of this flap, this tissue is removed. No. So this after elimination of this tissue, we are clearly able to see the bone. This is called as full thickness flap. Okay. Whereas in case of partial thickness, the incision is not through the periosteum. We are only giving till here. We are not completely touching the bone. So some amount of periosteum is left on the bone. This is called as partial thickness flap or split thickness flap. Okay, so full thickness flap we are performing. So if we want to view the bone, then if we are operating the bone, that means if we are performing any resective procedures or regenerative procedures, obviously we need to see the bone, right? In such cases, we will do the full thickness flap. Okay, whereas for the purpose of this periodontal plastic procedures, mostly we will use this split thickness flap or the partial thickness flaps. Okay, so now let's talk about papilla management. Okay, one second. Yeah, so in case of papilla management, we have seen that there are two types, that is a conventional and the papilla management. So what did I tell in case of conventional? So here, if suppose I give incision like this, okay. So I'm giving the incision on the buccal aspect, I'm giving the incision on the interdental area. So here, same, this is on buccal aspect, right? Same thing I will do on the lingual aspect. Now, what will I get? I will get a buccal flap, I will get a lingual flap. This is called as conventional technique, okay? Whereas in case of papilla preservation, what we do is, now I am passing the blade like this. Now, I won't give incision on this aspect. I will extend the incision and I will extend it the same on the palatal aspect also. So now my incision is like this. Okay, so on the buccal aspect, I am starting. I am extending to the palatal aspect. Okay, so now on the palatal side, I'm giving incisions like this. Okay, so now what happens? The whole palatal flap, you are able to get it onto the buccal aspect, right? You are including the palatal papilla onto the buccal aspect. Okay, so this is called as papillary preservation. You are preserving the papilla. Okay, so here we are giving an intrasulcular incision at the facial aspect, proximal aspects. Then you are extending on to the palatal aspect. Okay, so here you will reflect the papilla. You will perform the curettage. Okay, you will perform the scaling. Okay, after that, you will place the flap back into position and suture. So where are these sutures now? So here we are starting on the buccal aspect. We are giving an intrasulcular incision. Then we are entering palatally. On the palatal aspect, we are giving a semilunar incision. Okay, so this incision has to be 5 mm away. Okay, 5 mm away from the gingival margin. Later, we are reflecting this whole chunk of the tissue onto the buccal aspect. Then we are performing the debridement. Then we are suturing. So now the sutures are placed on the palatal aspect. This is called as papilla management. Okay, so we are preserving the papilla. So we are not giving incision onto the papilla. We are preserving that papilla. Okay. So next one is the gingivectomy. We will talk about some other surgical techniques. So first one is gingivectomy. Okay. So in gingivectomy, what you will do is initially you will mark the pockets. So you will measure the pocket depth with the help of a periodontal probe. And once you measure, you will make a bleeding point on the outer aspect. Okay. So this can be done with the help of a probe, or even you can use a pocket marker. Okay, so you will probe the pockets, and now the bleeding points are produced on the outer aspect. You will mark this location where you need to give the incision. Okay, so next, what is this kind of incision? You are giving an external bevel incision, right? So your incision is towards the coronal aspect. Okay, so the primary incision is given with the help of number 12B or 15 blade. Okay, so or else you can even use a knife. That is a Kirkland knife can also be used. Okay, you can give incision with the help of 12B or 15 number blade, or you can use a Kirkland knife. You will give the incision. Okay, so this is an external bevel incision. Later, another incision. This incision is called as primary incision. Next one is called as a secondary incision. Okay, so this secondary incision is given using Orban's knife or Weyerhaeuser knife or some modification of Orban's knife, sawtooth modification of Orban's knife. If you remember Orban's and Weyerhaeuser, it is more than enough. Okay. So after giving the primary incision, you will give a secondary incision. Okay. And you will separate this tissue. Okay. You will separate the tissue later. After the primary and secondary incisions, what you will do is you will remove the detached gingiva, whatever the gingiva that is left, you will remove this gingiva with the help of a curette or a scaler. Okay. Then you will thoroughly debride this area. Okay. Or whatever, after removing this gingiva, this whole area underneath this gingiva will be thoroughly debrided. You will perform the scaling. Okay. You will perform the scaling. You will remove the granulation tissue. Later, you will place the gauze pieces here. Okay, in order to prevent the bleeding. Okay, so these gauze pieces will be packed in the interdental areas in order to control the bleeding. Okay, next, later after doing this, again you will measure the probing pocket depths. Later you will place the periodontal pack. Okay, this is called as periodontal pack or dressing. So here, in case of gingivectomy, you are giving a primary incision, later a secondary incision. Now the tissue is detached tissue is removed. You'll perform the thorough debridement, and then you will place the gauze pieces to control the bleeding, and later place a periodontal pack. So now we learn about the original Widman flap. Okay, Widman in 1916 has given this flap. Okay, so here in this, first you're giving two releasing incisions are given. So two vertical incisions are given here. Two releasing incisions are given. Okay, so then you will give a intrasulcular incision, releasing incisions. After that, and the main objective of this original Widman flap is to eliminate the pocket and in order to perform the osseous recontouring. So here in this flap technique, you will perform the bone recontouring. Okay, so after giving this, what you will do is you will remove the inflamed collar of the tissue that is present. So you are giving two releasing incisions. You are giving the intrasulcular incision and you are removing the collar of the tissue, inflamed tissue that is present. After that, you will reflect the flap. So once you reflect the flap, what you do, you will be able to visualize the bone, right? So you will perform the bone recontouring. So you will perform the bone recontouring. Then you will place the flap back in position and you will perform the suturing. Okay. The buccal and lingual flaps are placed on the alveolar crest, bone crest, and then you will suture. Now, next there is modified Widman flap. Okay. So this modified Widman flap was given by Ramford and Nissel in 1974. Okay. So this is very, very important. Here, the first incision is placed at a distance of 0.5 to 1 mm away from the gingival margin. So first incision is given 0.5 to 1 mm away from the gingival margin. Next, in case of the second incision, after you will perform the second incision, in the second incision is an intracrevicular incision or a sulcular incision. So first incision is placed 0.5 to 1 mm away from the gingival margin. Second incision is intracrevicular incision. That means in the sulcus you will be giving. So now what happens? First incision is here, right? Second incision you will be giving in this sulcus. Okay, then what happens? This tissue is getting removed now. This chunk of tissue is getting removed. Okay, after that, you will give a third incision. Now, this third incision is made perpendicular to the root surface. Okay, this third incision is made perpendicular to the root surface. So, all this tissue gets removed. Okay, so next. After that, so complete the first incision, second incision and third incision are given. Later, thorough debridement is done. And now, you will place the flap back in position and perform the suturing. Okay, so first incision is 0.5 to 1 mm away from the gingival margin. An intracrevicular incision. Third incision is your perpendicular incision wherein you'll remove the whole tissue that is the first you have given incision, right? This whole tissue is removed in the third incision. Finally, you will give a, you will approximate the flap with sutures. Okay, so next we'll talk about Kirkland flap. Okay, this Kirkland flap is also called as modified flap operation. Okay, so Kirkland flap, the other name is modified flap operation. Okay, so in the Kirkland flap, the first incision that you're giving is, what is this incision? You're giving it in the sulcus. It is an intracrevicular incision or a crevicular incision or a sulcular incision, right? So now, after this incision is given, the gingiva is reflected, the flap is reflected. Okay, here you can see the calculus deposits and all. So you will remove the granulation tissue. You will remove the calculus deposits that are present on the root surface. So you will thoroughly perform the debridement. Then you will place the flap back in position and suture. Okay, so in case of modified Widman flap, you are giving three kinds of incisions. Whereas in Kirkland flap, directly first incision is only intracrevicular incision. Okay, next we'll talk about apically displaced flap. So here in apically displaced flap, the flap is positioned apical to its original position, right? The flap is positioned apical to its original position. That is why it is called as apically displaced flap. So in apically displaced flap, first following a vertical incision, so first you are giving a vertical incision, then a reverse bevel incision is given. Okay, a vertical incision is given, then a reverse bevel or an inverse bevel or internal bevel, right? Three are same. So this incision is given and this tissue is separated. This inflamed tissue is separated. Okay. So here all this tissue is removed with the help of a curette. Okay. Then you will perform the bone recontouring. So after the elevation of the flap, you are removing the, you are performing the bone recontouring with the help of a burr. Okay. So osseous surgery is performed here. Okay, after osseous surgery is performed, what is what we are doing? So this bone architecture is irregular. Now you can see that you are creating a regular bone architecture. So in order to create the physiologic contour of the bone, you are performing the osseous surgery. Later, what you are doing? You are placing the flap to a position apical to its original position and you are suturing it. Okay, so the flaps are positioned in an apical direction. Okay, then we are giving the suturing and we are placing the periodontal pack. Okay, so this is about apically displaced flap. Okay, now we'll talk about distal terminal molar flap. I have explained a basic idea in some of the classes. I don't remember the class, but I have talked about this distal terminal molar flap. Okay, so after the extraction of the third molar, sometimes there will be creation of a defect distal to the second molar. So in order to treat the defect that is present distal to the third molar, in order to treat the periodontal pockets on the distal surfaces of the molars, so which is very complicated. Okay, so for this, you will do the distal terminal molar flap. Okay, so here, as I have already told you, incisions. So here, what you will do is, your incision here is triangular. Okay, so in order to treat the defect here, your incision might be like this in the shape of a triangle, or you might give, yes, or you might give two parallel line incisions like this and then reflect, or you might even give a single, sorry. Oh, are you able to see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So, or you might even give a single line incision. Okay, so you might even give an incision like this triangular, or you might give two parallel incisions, or you might give a single incision. So now, this incision, where you are giving the incision, depends upon the amount of keratinized tissue. Okay, so wherever the keratinized tissue is present, there you need to give the incision. So if the keratinized tissue is more on the buccal aspect, you can turn the incision like this. You can give the incision like this. If it is more on the lingual aspect, you can give the incision like this. So depending upon the amount of keratinized tissue, your incision will be there. Okay, so now we have talked about incision. Flap is reflected. We have talked about different flap techniques. So now after the whole debridement, everything is performed, what you will do? You will place the flap in position. So as we have seen, according to the placement of flap after the surgery, there are two types of flap, non-displaced flap and displaced flap. So in non-displaced flap, as you can see, so first incision is given, everything, the flap is placed back in position to the same place as that of the, flap was previously present. It is, the flap is placed back after the surgery in the same position. So it is non-displaced. Okay, here also. So first here, they are showing the internal bevel incision. After giving the internal bevel incision, they're removing this whole chunk of tissue. We are placing the flap back in position. Here, in the second case, what they are showing is they are giving a marginal incision or a crestal incision. So by giving marginal incision or crestal incision, what we are doing? We are maximizing the keratinized tissue. So the keratinized tissue that is removed is less if we are giving the marginal incision. Later, what we are doing? What we are doing, we are again placing the flap back in position. So depending upon the keratinized tissue that is present, your flap placement will be there. Okay, your incision, your flap placement, or everything will depend on the amount of keratinized tissue that is present. Now, in case of apically displaced flap, what we are doing? Here, same. Okay, so we are giving the incision. Here, they are giving a marginal incision. Later, what we are doing? The flap is placed apically when compared to its previous position. The flap is apically displaced. Here also, the incision is given. This chunk of tissue is removed. Later, what we are doing? The flap is placed apically. So, the flap might be placed coronally also. You may even shift the flap coronally, apically, or laterally. Okay? So, after the flap adaptation, what you will do? You will perform the suturing. So, you need to understand this topic under these steps. First one is incision. Next is reflection of the flap. Later, you will do the debridement. Then the flap is coapted, flap is placed back in position, and you will perform the suturing, and finally you will give the pack. Okay, this is optional step. I hope everyone is clear with this. Thank you.